Good morning, everybody. I am Kevin Morales. I'm the editor-in-chief at the Cayman Compass. Thanks so much for joining us today. We have a very important discussion that we are happy to bring you on this Friday, the 17th of April. We have some of the leading mental health experts in the Cayman Islands joining us today for a live roundtable discussion where we're going to talk about protecting your mental health in these COVID-19 prevention measure times. We're going to take questions live from you. So if there's anything in particular that you want to address or that you have a question that you want to pose to the panel, please feel free to write that question in our comment section here on Facebook, and we'll be happy to ask the panel about it. So without further ado, let me introduce to you who we've got coming on today. And just bear with me one second here. There we go. All right. Right now on screen, you are seeing Ms. Shannon Seymour. She is the co-founder of the Cayman Islands Psychological Association. She's also the director at the Wellness Center. You can also see our panel on the side here of your page. Joining us as well is Dr. Mark Lockhart. He is the chairman of the Cayman Islands Mental Health Commission. We hope to be joined soon by Lexi Bodden, co-founder of the Cayman Islands Psychological Association. Sutton Burke, she's the director at Infinite Mind Care. And we also have Dallas Drolley Shetler. She is the marriage and family therapist at Infinite Mind Care. Dallas, I hope I pronounced your name right there. All right, good to go. All right, thanks so much for joining us, everybody. A very important discussion to be had, and we're pleased to have you all on to, again, talk about this very important topic and then also take some questions from the public as well. So let's start with this. Over the last month or so, as we've been going through these kind of lockdown measures, etc., what are you hearing from some of your clients, or, you know, what are some of the concerns that people are relaying to you?
Okay, I unmuted myself. So a lot of the concerns that I hear is just that state of overwhelm and a lot of the fears that come with constantly watching the news, going on social media, and, you know, being locked down here, but reading what's happening abroad, and that fear that it's coming, that there's the hospitals are going to get filled up, that someone in their family is going to unfortunately get this and pass away. And it's really just the fear that it's inevitable, that it's going to hit us strong, and just really feeling like they can't do anything about it. It's completely out of our control. And that certainly then leads to anxiety, overwhelm, less productivity, panic attacks, and really just sitting with lots and lots of fear. It's the main thing I would say that I'm seeing.
Yeah, I guess we're seeing a lot of what Sutton's talking about, and I think at the root of it is just that uncertainty, right? So there's an awful lot of uncertainty that's driving some of this, I think, at the root, people not really knowing what's coming next. So they're left to anticipate what might come, which is where we get to all the fear that Sutton was talking about. So people wanting to have sort of a sense of how do they plan their next couple of weeks or months, and how do we get into a routine? But there's so much, things seem to change so frequently. We're all glued to the press conference. It feels like, I think a lot of people that we're talking with, we're sort of seeing, I guess, a range. Some people who are coping well, who are feeling like they're finding opportunities in this, and other people who are having a great deal of difficulty. So I guess for us, there doesn't seem to be a single response, but it seems to be definitely lots of uncertainty, lots of fear and worry, and then that is exacerbating maybe if there were mental health conditions previously at play.
I can just jump in and kind of continue on with that theme. You know, that theme, that's really what I'm seeing with across the board, whether I'm working with just adults, couples, families, kids, teens, across the board, you know, we have this uncertainty now. And we collectively, we like to have control in our lives, or we like to think that we do. And that's the reality of like what often sparks a lot of mental health concerns and can be triggering right now, especially, is because all of a sudden, everything kind of went, we feel almost out of our control. Well, what's happening tomorrow, right? We're really living in a day-to-day basis right now of what's the next press briefing going to tell us? What are the new restrictions going to say? What's really happening locally and globally? So this has exacerbated those feelings of uncertainty, which really messes with our internal sense sometimes of what we're in control of. So that's just a theme in terms of what I've been really focusing on with practically all of my clients, I would say, is focusing right now on what we are in control of. This has brought that, this is like an existential concern that we have a lot anyways, but this has really brought it to the forefront, I think. So now we're all being faced with that collectively, is focusing in that, what we call that sphere of control. What are you in control of every single day, and investing your energy there? Because if we invest it outside of that circle, that's when anxiety and depression and other just feelings of panic and worries, that's when those are exacerbated. So a lot of this work right now that I'm sure we'll kind of continue to expand on today is about that, I would say, really focusing in our efforts, our mental health and everything into that sphere of control.
Excellent. All of you are right on target. And what we've really seen is that when we're dealing with any type of disaster or any type of major world-changing type event, there are certain predicted type patterns in terms of how we respond. Initially, after any type of disaster or when we first heard about COVID and there was the initial shutdown, there's what we call the heroic response, where most of us step up and say, we're going to fight this and we're going to help out and how can we contribute. Then there's what we call a honeymoon phase, which lasts for about the first 2 to 6 weeks of the process, where the community generally tries to come together. We try to support our elected officials to listen to what they're saying and follow. But as time goes on, we're seeing that there is an increase in terms of anxiety and other types of maladaptive type responses. As Shannon highlighted, we don't want to give the picture that everybody's necessarily doing bad, but this is a process. So an interesting fact is we see many times initially, many people who we would have expected to have had problems coping are actually doing well and said, I don't have to go into traffic. I don't have to rush into work and deal with coworkers. I feel more secure at home. I'm actually feeling that I'm being more productive at home. But 2, 3, 4 weeks in, then we start to see problems in terms of relating to that, and the isolation starts to set in. And that brings up another point that I'd like to throw out, and I'm sure the rest of the panel will join in, is being very careful of the terms and the terminology and that we use. I, from the beginning, did not like the term social distancing. And I did some research and some information on that. And it was after that I also saw many of my colleagues in the World Health Organization came out with their press conference about that. Social isolation is one of the core features of causing mental and emotional problems. And we know that. Apart from adverse childhood events, social isolation is the next biggest contributor. So anytime we use the term social in terms of social restriction and using social to limit things, we have to be very careful of the adverse consequences of that. So I really would try to push for us to use physical distancing, but social connectedness, which is what we need to get through this. And I'm sure the rest of the panel can join in.
Yeah, I think that's really important message, because the people that I'm sort of having connection to that are struggling are those people, some of the people that were in the mandated quarantine, and those people that maybe we're seeing, I'm seeing some real concern coming out of our community of expatriate people who maybe, especially those that are maybe new to the island. So they're not the ones that are able to sort of get all of the memes and enjoy and all that sort of social, collective, strength-based kind of humor that's around, all of the dialect and the jokes. I've had some people go, what does that mean? What's so funny about that? And I'm finding that really helpful personally sharing that with friends and family, and we're having a good laugh about it, and it's kind of giving us some energy to get through this, but other people aren't connected to that. And so we have to, that's where I see that kind of that distance, but also that it can trigger, or it can become that kind of real sense of being separate from your community, separate from those people, not even just physically, but then it becomes emotionally as well.
So I'm curious, Dallas, you in particular had mentioned kind of a sphere of things that you can control. Shannon, to that example that you just have, you know, that's something that somebody can't control. Do you have any tips for people to be able to compartmentalize and differentiate what they can control from what they can't? Because when we hear every day in new press briefings about new positive cases, about community transition, no, you can't do anything about that other than your own measures to protect yourself. But certainly it hits home because that's your community. And while you might say that's out of my control, certainly that causes anxiety no matter what. So I guess my question is, what can people do to sort of focus in on what they can't control, let go of what they cannot?
Mm-hmm. I think one important thing I think is, if we understand what I've been spending a lot of time doing, is explaining that what we are experiencing is a very adaptive evolutionary stress reaction. There is an imminent threat in our environment, and our brain knows it, it senses it. And so it's triggering sort of a sequence of things that is very important, keeps the species alive. It's a thing that we share with all mammals. And so it's not maladaptive, it's actually quite functional. And that we know that sort of the scanning of your environment and your heightened sense of alertness and attention to the environment is key. If you've ever watched National Geographic, you'll see, you know, the prey kind of goes on alert when the predator lingers near, right? And we are sort of the prey in this example, and this predator is changing every day. And so we're on this heightened sense of alertness, and we can't scan the horizon to see where the lion is. So we scan the internet, so we watch the press conference, so we watch the news, we ingest all of this information. It's really, in many ways, it's a neurological compulsion. It's our brain pushing us to do this thing because our brain doesn't know that the threat is COVID-19 versus a threat being a burglar busting in my front door, right? And so I do think we need to recognize that our need for information is neurological, but also we can be very careful about what information sources we're going to. And so I don't like when we start to criticize people, oh, turn off, don't look at the internet. I think that's an impossible thing to ask people to do right now. And it's just going to make them feel guilty if they can't stop. But to really encourage people, I guess, what is in your control is to choose really reliable sources, and to give yourself some structured time in which you're going to take information. You're going to watch the press conference at a particular time, or you're going to go to a particular website. You're going to watch a particular newscast so that you're still giving yourself that opportunity to get that information, but you're not kind of scrolling all day long. So I think what you can control is when and how, but what we don't want is people feeling guilty because they feel the need to.
If I can add on to that, you know, what you're saying, Shannon, is that this is a natural response to this abnormal situation, right? And we keep talking about that. This is your body responding in a natural way. And so we might not be able to prevent that fear from coming up for you, or that urge to walk, to have that news on, or to be scrolling, or to get on the phone and talk a lot about it. We might not be able to prevent the urge or that desire, but what we can do is try to catch ourselves doing it and come up with, you know, what's going to help me right now, and really get aware and in tune with ourselves of, is this really helping me, or is this, you know, adding to my extra, you know, overwhelm? Is this adding to those extra feelings that are coming up with, and what else can I do? So I really like that, because there's so many of us that are, you know, think about what can I feel guilty that we're not as productive, feeling, you know, so fearful and feeling guilty that we might be, you know, sharing that and that energy with other people. And it's really having compassion for ourselves, knowing that this is natural, and you know, trying to catch ourselves when we start to do it, and think of some alternative ways of dealing.
Mm-hmm. I, oh, Go ahead, Dallas.
Oh, that's okay. I just wanted to jump in on a couple of those things real quick. And if I can just say too, you know, as we're talking about all these different ways that we're all processing, everybody copes differently. And that's where that compassion comes in. You know, there is no one way to deal with this, just like with anything else in life, right? So we're going to see a lot of different ways that people are coping, and it's okay. So this is an in the day of social media, right? We can't help but see and compare ourselves to what everybody else is doing. And, you know, this can become really toxic. So yeah, just to even reiterate as well, and to reaffirm that, is that we have to limit our exposure to some of those things and resist that urge and desire to compare ourselves to what others are doing to cope and get through at this time. You know, I stress to my clients all the time, this is about you. You know, you do your best. What works for you in your life? You saw what that other person did on Facebook and on Instagram, and that's fantastic. They may have just completed some big project. Good for them, right? But that doesn't mean that that's how you have to cope in this time by being like ultra productive right now. Everyone is coping differently. And just to even go back, I just wanted to add that concept of that sphere of control again. I've encouraged people to, even sometimes if you're very visual, it can help to do this exercise to draw a big circle on a piece of paper and then draw another one, right? So we look at that, what's within our inner circle and then what's with outside of it, and literally write those things in there to see it, to visualize it. This is something to do individually. And I've encouraged families to do this, like to everybody, you know, the kids, that your teenagers, everyone can do this and then talk about it. And it can really help to just solidify, even if we have a concern then. So that thing that is outside of that circle, you can put the concern out there. But what steps can you take about that concern possibly? There's nothing we can do about COVID-19 in general, globally, right? But we can stay home. We can make sure we're washing our hands and take care of our family and our own health, for example, right? We can support our frontline workers, our first responders. We can do all these things. So that's what can help us, can remind us we do actually have quite a bit of control, and just learning to separate out the two.
All right. Thank you very much for that, Dallas. I'm sorry, Dr. Lockhart. I just want to introduce Lexi Bodden, co-founder of the Cayman Islands Psychological Association, has joined us. Lexi, thanks so much for being here. Really appreciate it.
Yeah. Apologies. I was a bit late. I got held up, but I'm glad I was able to make it. So thank you for asking me.
No problem. Thank you for being here. Let's kind of keep going off of what we were just talking about. What if there's somebody who maybe is having, I guess, some media overload, or is anxious because, yeah, they're seeing people being, whatever, I painted my house during this time off, and that person hasn't done it. And how can they recognize that maybe they do need to step away from social media, or they do need to turn the TV off, or schedule some time to get their information, as we've talked about before that? What are maybe the feelings that you may be having, or the symptoms, I guess, that you should be on the lookout for to say, wait a second, something might be up with me. I need to maybe reevaluate what I'm doing and go from there.
So a couple of things. First thing, adding to what we were just talking about in terms of control, I think it's important for us as mental health providers to also support what is being said in terms of what we all can actually do and the importance of what we can do, meaning there is no cure. There is no cure at this point for COVID-19. And in terms of even interventions that we as physicians are making, it's all supportive. Everything that you're hearing in terms of respirators and testing, it's not a curative intervention. It's a supportive intervention. So that support is equal to the support that every single person out there can give by staying home, by washing their hands, by wearing masks, by following the recommendations, which each and every one of you are also helping and contributing to the society at large. So if there's one mild criticism that I have, is that we need to be careful of being overly punitive with what you're doing or not doing, and you better do this and make sure. And balance that a little bit by saying, you know what, you staying home, not going on the beach, not congregating is actually helping us significantly. That contribution is just as powerful as the doctors in the hospital in terms of what we're trying to do. The second part of your question is watch for dysfunction in terms of our bodily type rhythms. So we know for sure that isolation and the lack of a schedule starts to throw off our daily body rhythm in terms of sleep and wake cycle. So many of us, as time is going on, find that you're sleeping in longer, staying up later. Those are things that you really want to watch. So if you hear all of us keep saying, and anytime, anything you look at from a mental health standpoint, talk about, set a schedule. Now, we're not saying you hold yourself to that schedule and not be flexible, but we need a schedule during this time. We need to watch for things that have to do with obsessive type behaviors, use of substances, overly worrying about catching. Now, what we're seeing is some of the patients that I treat with severe anxiety or OCD, obsessive compulsive type features, now it's starting to manifest where they're overwashing their hands and they don't want to touch family members and they're afraid of frontline workers being around them. And those are the things you want to watch for, that the thinking and the behaviors start to become a bit irrational. And sometimes we need family members to be able to highlight that type of behavior.
If I can piggyback on what Dr. Lockhart is saying in regards to keeping perspective. So when we talk about the government, when we talk about what's happening here, you know, by us doing our part, we have kept those numbers low. So that has really been something that we can control that's contributing greatly to our society and really keeping it in perspective. So when we start to compare ourselves to other countries or to other places and what they're experiencing, us doing our part has really helped with those numbers. And they keep reassuring us that we have those tests that are coming out and, you know, there's some hope in that way compared to, you know, other countries that aren't able to have as much control over keeping people at home and really using our, you know, first responders to help us with that. And people are really, for the most part, really abiding by that. And that's fantastic. And that's helping us greatly. So having that perspective that it isn't 10,000 cases here and 2,000 deaths. It's not that way. And our mind, though, plays that trick on us and starts to make us believe that it's something different. And so it's just, again, reminding ourselves and bringing us back to the reality of the situation and helping us to keep that perspective. And some ways that we can notice that if there's a, you know, we're having a little more of a problem or we're becoming a little more overwhelmed with those physiological symptoms and those changes that Dr. Lockhart is saying is also when we notice that there is a shift in our perspective and we start to be more fear-based and we start and, you know, maybe our friends and our family could catch us when we start to go down a road of, well, there's this imminent problem that's coming and there's all these cases, but in Cayman, that's just not true. Right. So we have had a lot of control by what we have been able to do to have that not be true. So it's really keeping that, you know, having that reality, you know, that reality based thinking, which is really difficult during this time because it's easy to go in that other way of thinking. And when we talk about these other concerns that, you know, that Dr. Lockhart is seeing with maybe the more severe anxiety cases, the OCD cases, you know, that's the fear where not all of our clients are in that realm. Some of them are doing very well, but when it comes to mental health and our fear of this becoming a larger mental health problem is when it starts to trigger other things other than, you know, that overwhelm and that anxiety, when it starts to trigger the, you know, washing your hands until they bleed or until they become raw. You know, now we're talking about that, you know, that OCD type of behavior and characteristic and symptom, you know, that those worry thoughts are really normal. But when we start to really, really worry and it starts to negatively impact our day on, you know, how we're able to get out of bed in the morning, if we're able to get up and, you know, take a shower. I mean, it's one thing that I think a lot of us are not, you know, maybe keeping that strict hygiene rule as best as we normally do. But if it becomes, you know, it's coming a few days where it's not happening and those worry thoughts are really taking over, that's when we start to notice that we might need to reach out to somebody.
I was just going to say, this is most definitely a quarantine beard going on. I probably need to check that. Dr. Lockhart, you had touched on substance abuse, and one of our commenters on our Facebook page had brought that up as well. Are you seeing substance abuse on the rise, and possibly from people who maybe were just social drinkers prior to this, Does this situation lend itself to possibly people maybe beginning some bad habits in that respect?
Yes, it does, Kevin. And unfortunately, during this point, most of the cases or the information that I'm getting is from partners as opposed to the actual person that is imbibing or using these substances. And that's an issue that we really need to watch. Now, there's something else that we need to keep in mind is that, I don't want it to be the bearer of bad news, but what we're going through, while we are managing it well, and we do have resources and tools that all of these experts can give to help us get that control and management, there are going to be long-term effects and changes worldwide for quite a while after this. We have lots of kids out of school, and not all of them are really on task and doing what they should. There are many that when we'd even had the schools, they had trouble and challenges that special needs and so on. We have people losing their jobs. There's going to be a change, a societal change from this for a certain extent. So there are going to be long-term consequences in terms of us coping and moving forward. And that's when we're going to see over time a lot of the emergent features of things like the substance use and there's an increase in domestic violence. I think the commissioner himself had made a reference to that in one of the briefings. And I'm hearing a lot about that. Now, again, I'm hearing it from a clandestine standpoint because many people are in situations where they're unable to move out or to leave. There are several situations I know of right now of couples that were ready to split up, but because of the situation, they have to remain in the same household with the kids. There's a lot of tension there. That causes a lot of disengagement and other problems that they're managing and keeping the roof on in a sense. But 3 weeks from now, 2 months from now, I think we're going to be seeing a lot of the manifestation of what's going on.
Yeah, and I
Dallas,
definitely.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to ask Dallas in particular because, Dallas works with families and in particular. So that's a very good point that Dr. Lockhart brought up was this is probably putting some relationships and people in some situations that they've never been in before, right? You're forced to spend maybe more time than you're accustomed to with your spouse, your partner, or your children. So what can you do to make sure that those relationships remain healthy and maybe what are some of the more common pitfalls that people fall into that we can try and avoid?
Absolutely. It's a great question. And honestly, I think that we could have a whole other topic on this alone, right? It's because this is one of the big concerns. I do see a lot of couples and one of the things, and of course, just adults talking about their partners. But one of the big things too is now going to this, if you're working from home, but you're home with your partner, right? And that's not the norm, especially people are in these close quarters and without any breaks. And first and foremost, I just wanted to normalize the fact that it is normal to get frustrated with the people that you live with, right? It's okay to feel that frustration with your partner and your kids. It doesn't mean that you don't love each other, right? I mean, we're talking about overall healthy relationships, first of all, and saying that it's okay to just have that frustration when we're used to being able to go out and, you know, have your normal day and you come maybe back together at the end of the day and debrief and all that. Now, people are quarantined possibly in one bedroom places. Right? It goes from we have a large space to spread out that energy in, and now it's being confined. And I know a lot of families that I'm working with, six people in a home, right? In just a two bedroom space. That's not a lot of room. And as much as possible, something that I'm trying to talk to people about, right, is even if it's just for a short time, can you find a way to respect everybody's privacy in some way? Like even to just get a little bit of time for yourself from your partner, ask for that need, you know? Hey, you know what? I really need some quiet time. I'm going to go into this room. Can I have that for the next hour? And maybe you need that as just a mental health break for yourself. That's okay. Just because we are quarantined or self-isolated together doesn't mean that you also have to spend all that time together. I think there's like a balance that needs to be found here, right? So in some ways, a lot of people are, yes, finding more quality time to spend together. And this is wonderful. And spending more time as a family or as with your partner, playing games, being creative, which is awesome. But then I think we also need to respect that there might need to just be some quiet time and some distance from that shared space all the time.
I think that's so true. And it's so true regarding parenting as well, I think, Dallas, because prior to this, I worked with a lot of families where children had anxiety, separation anxiety, or just general anxiety. And so those kids are loving this now, right? They're home with mom. They don't have to go to school. They don't have to go to brownies. They don't have to go to sports things. And their parents are there with them all the time. And one of the things we've been talking a lot about with those parents is to just continue to carve out a little bit of time where you're in the bedroom and kids are maybe, you know, in another bedroom, or you're going to have your shower and a bit of personal time without kids in the same room as you, to just kind of maintain this. Because, like, I agree with Dr. Lockhart, in those sort of situations, my concern is not so much right now. My concern is 4 months out, when these kids have to go back to school, we are going to find ourselves in a very tricky situation with kids who maybe had anxiety that was here before, and now they've had 4 months of home, and now they've got to go back to school. And those are the kind of concerns that I'm thinking about down the road. And that goes back, I think, to when we talk, check in on families. It's like, how are things going? Things are going well, because that thing that used to really cause distress is gone now, because we're all together. And so we're trying to help those families realize that what they do today and what they do on a daily basis is really important. And I think I've used the analogy of just like what, you know, we've sort of recognized who are our vulnerable people in our community, right? Medically vulnerable. And we're taking more preventative actions around them. We're not visiting them. We're not letting them go to the grocery store. We're really being mindful and cognizant of what we need to do to boost up the preventative measures regarding their health. And I think the same is true in mental health. So what we're doing today, even if it's tiny little things like showering by yourself, right? And letting kids go outside and play on the patio for 20 minutes on their own. Those kind of little tiny things that we can do on a daily basis, I don't think we can minimize the impact, the positive impact that they can have 6 months later when we all sort of start to reemerge or start to kind of get back into life as a community.
I have two things. One, if I can piggyback on what Shannon is saying again, is the reason for that, and because what we're afraid of, what could happen in 4 months from now, is creating that separation anxiety, right? Where now the child has looked at this whole situation of, you know, having a savior or feeling safe because mom and dad or whoever was right there with them. And that's why they were kept safe. So then when they go to leave the home, it's, well, I'm not safe unless my mom and dad are with me, because we were just in this situation and they were always by my side, and that's what's helped me. So it's really what we normally call that is like the reassurance. You know, they get that reassurance that they're okay from mom and dad, as opposed to actually, I can be safe on my own. I can regulate my own emotions. I can feel calm. I can feel relaxed without someone being right there to rub my arm or hug me to bring that sense of safety. So yeah, that's so important to, I love those tips for parents. The other thing is that I heard Dr. Lockhart talk about is the drug and alcohol, drugs and alcohol. And certainly during this time, people who have struggled in the past or were struggling before, this is going to be that now it's almost like justifying that they're allowed to, right? Like, well, I'm home by myself. I get my work done. And of course I can have not just a drink. I can have, you know, 5 drinks. I can have 6 drinks. I can, you know, black out and to pass out at night, because I don't have to wake up necessarily at 7 in the morning, at 8 in the morning to get on the road. So we really want to watch that, of how we, you know, what we allow ourselves to do and the permissions that we give ourselves during this time. And if you were struggling before, how do we, how do we work on that now? Also, I really am concerned for people who are in the recovery community, who have maybe went to treatment and have been doing so well for, you know, 6 months, 1 year, 5 years, you know, and how they manage this time. Because, you know, what we were talking about is that isolation and that social isolation and that lonely feeling, that sense of loneliness really takes an impact on someone who struggles with substances. So for those people, it's being extra vigilant during this time. And really, you know, if it's someone that works a 12-step program or a SMART program, or just, you know, really takes ownership of their own sobriety, really putting measures in place, even extra measures that have already been taken place right now, because this is an especially vulnerable time of just not being able to leave, of not being able to do those things that you might have in place that normally helped you before. Like, you know, if you're feeling extra anxious or feeling triggered or a craving, you know, maybe you would go out and take a run at, you know, 8 o'clock at night, at 9 o'clock at night, where now you can't do that. So what's going to be the alternative? And almost the importance of planning before it happens when you're someone in that situation, because we have at our clinic, we have received more substance. We have a drug and alcohol treatment program, and we have received more calls and more inquiries on that program right now. And it's certainly a good opportunity to start, you know, getting assistance if you are someone that needs it. But for someone that doesn't feel they need it yet, how do we just, you know, prevent ourselves from getting in that place? And it's really monitoring what you tell yourself, what permissions you give yourself, and really understanding your behavior. Like, actually, am I not just drinking one glass of wine? Now I'm drinking the whole bottle by myself. And it's okay, because no one's around and no one has to see that I don't look my best the next day. Really that, you know, brutal honesty with yourself, and hopefully from your family and friends in a loving, caring way that they can talk to you about it.
So I just want to talk about the word moderation, and Lexi, maybe I can bring you into the conversation here, because I saw when Shannon started talking about parents and the relationship with children, you were nodding. So to Sutton's point, right, we might be setting ourselves up to some degree for some separation anxiety down the line. At the same time, I think parents, actually, I'll just speak personally, I've enjoyed spending, I guess, more time than normal with my children, because I'm home all the time. So I think parents are feeling some pressure right now to try and balance being there for their children, who might be kind of scared right now because they see things on the news and you want to support them, but you also, you know, something like you said, you can't spend 24/7, I guess, coddling them. You're also feeling pressure because you want to perform still at work. You are feeling pressure possibly to make sure that things are staying normal as much as can be with your significant other. What can people do to sort of balance all these factors and I guess all these pressures that you might be feeling in your life to make sure that you're surviving without constant anxiety about not, you know, living up to maybe your own expectations as a parent, yeah, as a professional, as a significant other, et cetera.
Yeah. And if I can just add, so kind of from that, but also from the previous discussion, so a lot of my clients are teens and young adults. And so especially the ones coming back from school, you know, are in a bit of a different situation as well. I've got a lot of parents that are super excited. They have their kids trapped and they get to spend all this time with them. I've got some parents that are like, I don't know what to do. We've not seen them in a while, and trying to figure out, they're now adults, but now they're back in the home. And for the teens and the young adults who are so used to relying on their friends and having more independence, and how do they function being back at home with everyone? Because I have a lot of families where now there's like three adult children, two adult children home, you know, back in the family home with mom and dad. And if there's grandparents, you know, other family in, and trying to navigate that. So with especially the young adults and the teens, trying to help them stay connected to friends as well, and keeping their social connections. Because really for them, a lot of their support is going to come from that. That's their way of venting, of connecting with others, normalizing their experiences, and getting information on how friends are coping. Alex Panton Foundation has a Facebook group to help with that. And there's lots of online resources, which are great. But then that will take care of some of that support, so then they can enjoy some of the time with families. And I loved what Della said. Yes, there's going to be frustrations, and that's absolutely normal. So I've been helping a lot of them, you know, have some potentially difficult conversations to figure out how their schedule and their routine can work for everyone. So as Dr. Lockhart said, that schedule is helpful. It's more predictable and we have an idea of how it's going to work. So especially if there's more than one person in the house, especially multiple adults, that's often helpful to have an idea of who's doing what when, and who's to do which responsibilities within the house. To your point, I think it's important to manage expectations. I saw something on Facebook yesterday that said, you're not working from home, you're at home working during a crisis. And I think that that's really important. You know, I've heard several references to social media. There are some people who look phenomenal on social media that are homeschooling and still maintaining their full-time executive jobs and cooking up brilliant meals and still exercising. And so it's not fair to compare our reality to what I call someone else's highlights reel, right? They do something, they snap a picture and it looks great, but that's not, you don't see the whole picture of what's actually going on. It's important to know everyone else is feeling the tension right now. So all of us are going to be having some level of stress reaction, even if we're not feeling consciously worried. Our bodies are responding because things aren't normal. Things aren't like they normally are. So even if we're not feeling overwhelmed, all of us are going to be having some kind of reaction to what's happening. And so I think it's important to make a list of what you want to get done for the day, but be realistic about it. You know, have your to-do list, but also bring in things that are important to you. I've been encouraging everyone to get their 90 minutes of exercise. Getting outside and getting active is one of the best ways to burn off that physical stress that we're feeling. Even if it's coming across in high emotions, physical exercise is a great way of managing our body's fight and flight response and helping your arousal levels to go down so that you can enjoy things again and that you can have that conversation with, you know, the family member that has been getting under your skin a little bit. So managing expectations, but then also planning, right? So having certain things that you enjoy that are good for you, bring in your personal time, like Ms. Shannon had said, and like Sutton said, to manage that stress, especially if you know that there are difficult times or difficult situations, plan ahead for it if you can. So if you know that, like I've got some clients, sometimes the evenings are a bit of a trigger for them. So what we'll do is try to find something that they can do in the evening that's enjoyable to help to get them through that time. And because professionals aren't in their offices in the evenings, you know, having a support or a plan that they have someone who's able to be there for them during that time.
I think a really important piece too is the reality that even though we are experts, maybe in the field of mental health or in psychology or psychiatry, we are going through this exact same situation with everybody at the exact same time. We didn't have the heads up. We didn't take a course. We weren't ready. And so I think to recognize, and I know we've been doing that a lot as a staff, is just kind of joining our entire community in what this experience is like. And so we can sort of act the experts, and we certainly have a foundation of knowledge and many, many years of experience in understanding behaviors and emotions. But I think it's also important that we as caregivers kind of recognize that we are going through this with the people that we're supporting. And I think being really honest about that, right? That we're not standing here with all of this knowledge to impart, but we're walking along this journey with the community. And I think that's a really important message because we're all human too, right? And we're going through this, the same exact experiences. And it's great that we can use our knowledge, but I think that as clinicians, one of the things I've seen, I think it's to Dr. Lockhart's point, is there's an awful lot of advice giving and do's and don'ts giving, as opposed to just, you know, listening and just saying, yeah, that sounds really hard. And as opposed to like, oh, well, you should do A, B, and C. I think there's definitely a place for that advice and all of it's really important. But I think it's also important for the community to know that everybody's going through this together. And so your situation is unique to you, but there's also I get a great deal of comfort in knowing that other people are also sharing the same experience that I'm sharing. And that helps me. And I know the Psychological Association has been having weekend meetings where we're getting all of the directors of all of the clinics together to just kind of share about what's this like. And I think it is important. And even as mental health care providers, for us to care for ourselves is a great, we need to do that so we can care for the community. Parents need to care for themselves so they can care for their children. Teachers need to take care of themselves so they can continue to teach. Our doctors, I certainly hope, you know, Dr. Lee and Dr. Williams and our government are taking some time for themselves because we're looking to them to continue to care for us.
it's that, you know, saying that we keep hearing is we have to put our oxygen masks on first before you put it on for somebody else. And that's so true for, you know, for us clinicians as well, in order for us to be able to walk alongside our clients and work with them is, you know, check in on ourselves and how we're doing. You know, we all look beautiful today. I don't know, you know, like I definitely put makeup on. This is my one time of putting makeup on and putting on a dress for the week, being out of sweatpants and a nice top is my normal thing for when I'm seeing a client. So it's nice that we look at ourselves and see how we can work on it. You know, the biggest tool that I use on a daily basis is the idea, and we spoke about this at our director's meeting, of one day at a time. So every day for me, I'm focusing on what do I need to do today? What are the restrictions that are placed on me? I don't want to know everything. I only want to know what I need to do to keep myself safe, my family safe, and the community. So I know I need to stay in today. These are the new rules. And what do I need to get done today that's going to, you know, help the business, help my clients, and bring some joy in my life? You know, how am I keeping myself healthy? So it's the constant, the reminders that we need to do it as well, just so we can get through this and, keeping it all in perspective, right. And keeping a good head on at the same time.
Yeah. I just wanted to add something. Lexi.
Go ahead, Dallas.
I just wanted to say something that's kind of come up for me, and I just wanted to be able to kind of add, you know, in a summary to a lot of the things that we've been talking about. To me, and what I've been discussing with so many of my clients is paying attention to your energy level. And I think that's actually been coming up in our discussion without really addressing it directly. But through all of these things with social media and comparing ourselves to others and all these expectations, paying attention to your energy level. What is building and replenishing your energy right now, and what is draining it? So I think that goes back to even a question that you'd asked a little bit earlier, Kevin, you know, how can we pay attention to some of these signs and symptoms? My biggest thing would be to just tune into yourself, that internal situational awareness. What's going on for me right now? Am I feeling more depleted after speaking to that person or after scrolling through social media or watching the news, you know, whatever it might be? Am I feeling anxious? Am I feeling lower? Let's look at that. And it's not to say that you have to completely cut that stuff out, but maybe you do, or maybe you drastically limit it. Maybe you choose the time and space for that person, that thing that you do need to access, and really focusing, you know, yes, we're talking about what you can do to stay busy and stay active. I would really encourage people to come up with like that more of an energy list. Like, what are those things that are replenishing and rebuilding your energy right now? So it doesn't have to be completing a big project or, you know, cooking this amazing meal. It could be. But sometimes that replenishing my energy can look like I need to sit, I need to breathe, I need to pray, I need to meditate, read a book, whatever it might be, rather than this sort of, and I just wanted to throw this out there too, we have this term called toxic positivity, and I'm seeing a lot of that right now too, and in terms of, you know, really shaming people if they're not being uber productive and being really positive about this and looking at the bright side of things. Yes, we need to keep the big perspective, like that big picture and the positive perspective, but it doesn't mean that we have to shame ourselves if we're not accomplishing certain things right now. I've just seen that, and I really wanted to address that because I see that as a really big theme on social media. There was a meme, I think that we're all pretty, it seems like we're all pretty up to date on those big memes that have gone around, which is great. But one of them said, you know, if you don't come out of this thing with a new skill, it's not that you lacked time, it's that you lacked discipline. I totally disagree with that. And I'm sure my colleagues also agree with that as well, because that's shaming us for the way in which we're coping, right? This is not necessarily the time that you're going to be motivated to learn a new language, and that's okay. If you are focusing on your wellness every day, showering, taking care of your needs and your kids' needs, your partner's needs, that is enough. And that's the biggest thing that I just hope to be able to stress to people. I just wanted to make sure that we could identify that.
Yeah, well, and that's what I was going to say as well, is I think it's been kind of shifting from like the immediate crisis mode to more kind of like long-term, finding this kind of new normal, at least for right now. And so that's where, you know, a lot of times the busyness and the pressure comes from the initial anxiety and the crisis. But really, it is going to be figuring out, you know, what is a realistic work level for the day, and that it is okay to have days where you don't necessarily get up and put on makeup and everything. But, you know, and to give yourself that time and have compassion for yourself and that, and that that's okay too, that it's everyone's lives are different right now. So figuring out what's going to work for you for the long term. Not we've got these little kind of little crisis survival things, but longer term, what's it going to look like for us?
Right. And one of the things, question, Kevin,
go ahead, Shannon.
Sorry, Kevin, you had asked the question, were you asking the question, how do you get help or how do you know when you need help? And I think one of the things, I'm aware of our time limits, and I think it's important that people recognize that if they do feel like they need to speak to somebody, that they can speak to somebody. And so all of the providers that are in this meeting, plus all the other providers on island, are available on telehealth. I know that there's been lots of discussions behind the scenes and advocacy to make sure that those mental health services are covered by our health insurance providers. I know that the mental health helpline has been established. I know all of the government counseling services are online and ready to serve. And so I think if you are doing all the things that we've been talking about and you're being compassionate on yourself and you're having your schedules and you're doing all these wonderful things, but you're still feeling like you're not doing well or you want to talk to somebody, then there's lots of support available in our community. And it's finding somebody that you're comfortable talking with. And I think it's really important that we stress that while we can talk about all this prevention stuff, it's also really important that if you need care, you get care. And it's available. There's a lot of people, those of us in this meeting right now and other people in our community are available. So talk to your primary care physician, reach out to the mental health helpline, but don't feel like you have to kind of just persevere through this. There is help available, and it's important that people access that help if they feel it need it.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
This is a weird time, right? This is a scary time. This is a bizarre time. This is an unusual time. This is a time that has never happened before in any of our lifetimes that are on this panel and anybody that I know. So this is a weird time, and there's no perfect antidote. There's no exact way of how you feel, but what we do know, you know, what Dallas was saying, if you know that you know you are at that low energy level, if you start noticing the changes in energy, the changes in your sleep, the increased drinking or substance use, the, you know, lack of hygiene where you just don't care anymore, if you're feeling that hopelessness and it's just too difficult to manage to take care of yourself or to, you know, take care of those other people in your household, you know, there, that's the time to reach out, and it's okay. That's what we're here for.
I just want to say very quickly that as long as the members of the panel have time, we have time as well, so I don't want anybody to think that we're under any sort of major time constraint here. So please continue on as long as you can. Go ahead, Dr. Lockhart.
So I just wanted to really underscore what we were just talking about in terms of reaching out for help if you really feel that you need help. All of the practitioners that are here are participating in teleconferencing or telemedicine, health type platforms, as are others who are not part of this panel. One thing I would like to ask the general public to do, though, is not only reach out to any of us if they require help, but I would like them to reach out to their insurance companies, because I do not feel that the insurance companies have stepped up to the plate in the manner in which they should. All telehealth type interventions have been approved in Bermuda. So if you were living in Bermuda right now and you needed to talk for an hour with any of these therapists, it's fully covered by insurance. That's not the case here in Cayman. The insurance companies have come out and made a statement that they're here with us and they're covering all the COVID type aspects of what's going on. But they've cut back on the mental health coverage. They have approved a few codes for teleconferencing or telemedicine, but they have not approved any codes for 60-minute sessions, which is what all of these providers provide. So we're still here because we can't abandon our patients and clients. But I feel that the insurance companies have continued to abandon the community. And I've made that statement and I stand by it.
I stand by everything that you say, Dr. Lockhart, and in total agreement, please reach out to your insurance companies. These are benefits that you pay for, that you are entitled to have through your insurance, that you know, your insurance provider that you've always had, and certainly a time of crisis, this is when we need it more than ever.
Yeah, definitely. And I think the Psychological Association has been pushing back and trying to secure written confirmation from all the various companies. What are they covering? We've had a few situations where they will say they're covering something and then a claim is denied. So it is an issue. I'm glad Dr. Lockhart brought it up. And I think it is, the power lies not in the provider. The power lies in the person who pays their premium. So as a consumer of health insurance, my power is with the company that I give my money to every month. And so that's where our power lies in this situation, to make sure that we're still paying our premiums at full rate. They haven't reduced our premium costs, so they shouldn't be allowed to reduce their coverage costs.
So we had a meeting. We had a meeting yesterday with various stakeholders, and one of the representatives of the insurance company said, "We're not hearing any complaints." I brought up the whole issue of having coverage for more than 30 minutes of a telephone session, and they said, "You know what? We haven't had one complaint from any of our members that have been covered." So, and again, I felt that that was disingenuous, because people in general that are going through mental health and in emotional crises are not the ones at the forefront making calls and making marches and out in the middle of the street. So I think we need to advocate for that.
I also think what's happening, Dr. Lockhart, though, is that for many of us, our administrative bits of our businesses are not fully operational. So those claims aren't going in, or those statements aren't going out. And so clients may be getting the service. It's like, if I went to my doctor and I got my care, I don't have the bill yet to see what my insurance company hasn't covered, right? And so I think that could be part of where this thing is, where they're saying we're not hearing from anybody yet.
Correct. And they also had the nerve, in a sense, to say yesterday that they're seeing no decline in claims. Everything is the same as it was before COVID. Look outside on the street and just look and see that people are not out. That's impossible to say that. So, and then eventually when challenged on it, they brought up and said, well, yeah, maybe there is a delay. We haven't actually seen the claims for right now yet. So anyway, I don't want to turn this into talking and focusing on the insurance companies, but I really want to use this to empower those that are listening to this talk, that you should get on the line and call your insurance company just to make sure what coverage you have, because your premiums have not changed. There's been no decrease in what you've paid for.
Well, and Dr. Lockhart, we had talked the other day about, this is the last thing that people need right now who are feeling anxiety, who are battling some sort of mental health issues. You don't want to worry about money in a time like this, essentially.
And that's it, Kevin. And I don't want to make the focus on money, as I told them. What it is that services have been reduced from my standpoint. 4 weeks ago, at this particular time at 1 o'clock, I could have a patient come in and sit down for a 60-minute session, which is what they need, and we could supply that to the insurance company and that be covered. Right now, because of the public health intervention that we all need to abide by, which is keeping this social distancing and being isolated at home, we're telling everyone, stay home. The insurance companies are saying, yeah, but we're going to cover everything to do with COVID. But what they've done, the only codes that they're going to allow you to use is a 30-minute session for me to talk with you. They're not allowing a 60-minute session. They're not going to cover that. So your coverage has been lessened from a mental health standpoint during a time when the mental health component, in my opinion, is just as serious as the physical component of COVID. It's not as dramatic right now, but it's under the surface and it's brewing and building.
No, I agree. I think that, you know, that right now is when people need the support and need the services, and people who are already accessing services need it to continue. You know, even if they are in the ideal situation right now, having your provider drop off, I know even like we go on vacation for a few weeks, and for a lot of clients, it's really difficult to cut services in a time where people need it the most. You know, will create its own crisis is my concerns. You know, even if they were doing okay when they had their services as usual, cutting back will have other effects.
All right, thank you all for that. I would like to ask some very specific, but I guess practical questions and see if you all might have some recommendations. One of the things we talked about before we got going with this roundtable was that for a lot of people, they're working from home now, places where they used to be able to relax and unwind and maybe get some of that energy back that we had talked about before, have now been turned into office spaces. For instance, my bedroom, where I used to be able to come take a nap, has now turned into my office space. And I'm sure it's that way for a lot of people. What can people do to still sort of separate their work from their personal life where they can recharge, even though in terms of the space, those might be the same place now?
I think a lot, everybody, you know, unless you have one of these really big spacious houses with all kinds of extra, rooms, that most of us are kind of dealing with the same exact thing, Kevin. And I think creating activity, I guess, or transition activities that kind of signal the end of work and the beginning of personal time. So it might be that you close your laptop and you cover that table with a blanket, and you change out of your work clothes and you put on your PJs. So in many ways, it's kind of fabricated. It might seem a bit odd, but it's the only thing, or it's the best thing that we can do right now, is trying to find activities that can signal our brain almost that work is over and home time has begun. And I've talked to a lot of accountants right now that are in the middle of busy season that are reporting, I kind of like roll out of bed straight to the laptop, and are finding that they sit there all day for 12 hours. And so trying to create some kind of activity, maybe you go outside and walk around the block before or after, at the end of and the beginning of that work period, so that there is some kind, we don't have the ability to create the distinction with space. So we can create the distinction with some kind of activity.
It also goes back to routine. So when we get up in the morning, you know, keeping that routine of I make my bed, keeping the routine of I brush my teeth and I take a shower, all of those things, I know for me personally and for the clients that I work with, that is extremely helpful to see that bed made. It's not, you know, especially for you, Kevin, with the example of, you know, working in the office. If you see that unkept bed, you know, it might make you want to go lay down in it and think that it's, you know, this is lay down time and relaxation time versus work time. So really keeping that routine in, again, I've already used myself as an example. I'm not dressing up every day. I'm just changing out of pajamas and putting on sweatpants. But at least there is a change. Whereas I know some people are struggling with just, I roll out of bed and I just go sit down and start working. Really prep yourself. Give yourself that time in the morning. If you're sleeping in even, you know, and you're not waking up as early as normal, that's okay. That's fine. You give yourself permission to sleep in a little bit. It's nice to get recharged, especially because there's probably a lot of sleep disruptions that are very normal during this time. But get up. Go get your cup of coffee, you know, read a little bit, go for your, you know, for 30 minutes of exercise, like Shannon was saying, go walk and, you know, then come back, put your work, you know, a fresh shirt on, you know, sit down to do what you have to do. But, you know, it's trying to keep certain parts of that routine and then building other things in to have the start and close of your day.
And you had mentioned, Sutton, there's bound to be a lot of sleep disruptions right now. And this is probably an issue that goes beyond just the current environment with COVID-19. But for people who might be experiencing that, any tips on what people can do to, you know, if you wake up at whatever, 1 a.m. and your mind starts racing, you start thinking about COVID, you start thinking about work, whatever the case may be, what can you do to sort of, I guess, shut back down and get in a place where you can fall back asleep before you've been up for 3 hours, and you know, that's not healthy.
Sure. So I also want to normalize, like, having sleep disruption at this time, so normal. Now we know sleep, you know, having disruption in your sleep, it comes along with so many other mental illnesses and mental health concerns. And especially if you're not getting a certain amount of sleep every night that's workable for you, you're going to really have a negative impact in your day. So we want to watch out for those things. And that's then when we talk about reaching out to a professional, if you're not sleeping at all, or you're having so many disruptions that you're not having, you know, a certain level, when you wake up in the morning, you feel really depleted of energy. But you know, some tips are definitely, you know, keeping that sleep hygiene before you go to bed, you know, shutting down the electronics, turning off the lights, turning off this, you know, having it, no noise, keeping the, you know, AC nice and cool in the house. I always encourage people to write out any worry thoughts before they go to sleep, you know, an hour before. So it's not like right before, just to get it out of their head. Like, okay, this is something that's coming, going on my mind. These are things that I have to do tomorrow. So let me just write it all out, get the list prepared for tomorrow. So then I don't have to wake up in the middle of the night and go, oh my goodness, I forgot something. And if you are that person that, you know, one is waking up thinking about what you maybe have to do tomorrow, write it down. If it's the COVID stuff, right? If that's what's waking you up and you're feeling that sense of overwhelm, you know, really practicing your breathing exercises. Again, practice the perspective, bringing perspective. Okay, right now I'm safe in my bed. You know, tomorrow I'm not going out. It's not my day to leave the house tomorrow. So I probably, you know, I'm not going to be around anybody. You know, really bringing that back. There's also different meditations. I encourage everybody to get those different sleep apps or look them up on YouTube. You know, listen to a bedtime story for adults. I'd love that. You know, counting backward from 100. There's so many different techniques that we can do when we wake up. But I would say the most important thing that we can do if we're having sleep disruptions is to not judge ourselves or punish ourselves or say something is wrong with us. Because what typically happens, and speaking from experience, because I have experienced my own sleep disruptions myself of, you know, getting really mad. Oh my gosh, I can't believe I'm waking up right now. It's 3:30 in the morning. This is the third time I've done this week. I'm going to be so, you know, messed up in the morning. I'm not going to be able to function. I have a meeting. When we get into that cycle of thinking, what it does is it makes the anxiety and the sleep problem worse. So it really, that cognitive structure of things really messes with our sleep. So we really want to catch ourselves and go, you know what? Waking up like this, normal. I'm going to be able to get myself back to sleep. I know I can do, you know, like, let me, sometimes if you're, we don't want to stay in bed too long when you've woken up. Maybe it is time for you to transition from your bed to the couch at 4 a.m. if you've already been up for a half an hour stressing out. Transition to the couch, start to read a book, not a good book, a boring book that you really don't want to read. Not, you know, the book that's taken you a long time to get through. Try to do something to really relax yourself. Do not turn on that TV at 4 a.m. You know, it's enticing, but we want to do something that's going to keep us, you know, in that calm, relaxed, bored, sense that's going to help, you know, remind our body that it's time for sleeping.
Sutton, you hit on, like, you know, most of the important things for sleep hygiene, as we talk about all the time. And you mentioned this, the technology and screen time. And that's the one I just wanted to emphasize again, because I think that's something, again, right now, that's even more triggering for people and disrupting their sleep. And I think most people have been guilty of it. I know that I have as well, is that when we wake up, we grab and reach for our phone. Is that the first thing that you do when you wake up in the morning or in the middle of the night? If you reach for your phone, let's work on trying to make that not the first thing that you do, right? Because that immediately it engages you. You, even if you're checking it to see what time it is, but you see that you have 8 WhatsApp messages and there are notifications from all these other apps, it's going to immediately spark all of those thoughts in your mind, right? So if the goal is to wake up and be peaceful and to not let ourselves get immediately overwhelmed to start our day or in the middle of the night, we need to try and, you know, implement a different habit, I would say, as much as possible, even by delaying looking at your phone for the first 5 minutes or whatever it might be, but starting it in a different way. And if you're waking up in the middle of the night or having trouble level going to sleep, limiting that screen time is one of the best ways that we can help ourselves in that. It's also one of the most challenging. I know when I talk to clients about, you know, sleep experts and what they say about we shouldn't be on technology 2 hours before they go to bed. And everyone looks at me like, are you crazy? Who's not getting on their phone 2 hours before bed and all that? And I get it, right? And I'm in the same boat, obviously. What I talk to people about, though, is harm reduction, being realistic. You know, can you reduce the brightness on your screen? Can you make the background that yellow background instead of the blue light, which is so terrible for our sleep? And can you try and just limit it, at least in that last hour and a half hour before bed? Find that book and, you know, implement something else that can be soothing for you, because that technology is going to disrupt our sleep a lot. And we're finding that even more so now with the overconsumption of news and even more late night binges of Netflix for a lot of people right now without other things to do. But that is a really negative cycle. It goes hand in hand with our sleep disruption. So that's just another thing I wanted to kind of expand on that's really important for our sleep hygiene.
Yeah. And if I could add, there's things that we can do during the day as well to try to set ourselves up for a better night's sleep. So things like not like limiting caffeine intake. You know, all of us are at home. I know my soda consumption has gone up. You know, we've got lots of food around. We've got lots of sodas, coffee. You know, there's different things that we might rely on, but caffeine activates us. And so that can cause sleep disruption. So you might get to sleep and then wake up from the caffeine in your body later. Alcohol also affects sleep. So you might be able to go to sleep, but as it leaves your body, it will actually wake you back up. So I have a lot of people talk about having a nightcap. Really, that's actually not very helpful. So limiting caffeine and alcohol, even smoking close to bed, trying to reduce those with a couple of hours before bed. Exercise during the day can be a way of burning off some energy since we're not out and about and moving around like we normally do. So bringing in exercise can help. Preferably not close to bed either, because you don't want to get your heart rate up before you try going to bed. And also getting sunlight. Sunlight during the day helps your body to rebalance and reactivates your circadian rhythm. So your body realizes, okay, this is daylight. This is where I need to be awake, which is the issue with the blue light on the phone that Dallas was talking about, is that the blue light makes your body think it's daytime and it needs to wake up. So especially if you can get morning sunlight, that's often really helpful as well. So those are a few things you can do during the day to set yourself up. And I'd say even if you are having difficulty sleeping at night, get up in the morning anyway, just like you normally would. That way your body will begin to get into a routine, because our body likes to have habits and likes to know what to expect. So that way your body will begin to realize, okay, I need to go to sleep at night because I do have to get up at 6, 7, 8 o'clock in the morning anyway. And trying to avoid naps as well if that's become an issue.
So everything is right on par. Just to piggyback on that. Studies have shown that physical and social isolation actually in itself plays havoc with the sleep-wake cycle. So when we are isolated or apart from a normal routine of going out and doing things, what starts to happen generally is that we stay up longer and we sleep in later. And that's been a proven fact for quite a while. So the reason I'm highlighting that is that adds a little bit to the normalcy that I want everybody to take away from this. That even if you found that things were really well and what's going on, I'm having a little harder time falling asleep or I'm waking up a little bit later, you have to kind of take in consideration that the changes and what's going on with us being isolated is also playing a havoc on that balance. So even more so in terms of what Dr. Bodden was saying is that what you need to do in the day is just as important as the sleep hygiene things that Dallas and Sutton were talking about. So it's really putting that balance, and it comes full circle again to what we were saying about trying our best to set a schedule, not setting it in stone, not being inflexible, but trying to use those things. Another thing that Shannon really hit on, no matter how small the space is, we can change it and rearrange it. So, you know, in terms of your bedroom, Kevin, what you need to do is like when you're working, you set it up for a work way and move it around in a different way in the evening or so on. Going back to something else we were talking about earlier, it's extremely important as part of that scheduling that we get time for ourselves and that we ask our partners, our friends, or whoever to give me a gift. Can I have a little gift of an hour later this afternoon, or I'm going to go for my exercise alone? And it's not that I'm upset with you. It's not that I'm shunning you. But it gives me that time to kind of calibrate in my mind what I'm dealing with or what I have to address. So not being shy and not being overly sensitive about talking with our significant others, if we do have somebody in our life, for the importance of carving out a little time, no matter how small that space is, and respecting that person's time. There's one patient of mine that they live in a one-bedroom apartment, and it's three of them. It's the parents and a small child. And what they've done is that they've adjusted the bathroom. So, you know, they've like moved the shower curtain around or so on, and they have time where like one of them would take a bath or sit there or have extra time, and you kind of leave mommy there and leave dad, and they get their time and they use the bathroom as a quiet type area. Whatever you have to do, but the key is not to feel guilty and build up resentment because of your partner or your significant other wanting a certain amount of personal time.
Let me wrap up with this, and it's kind of circling back to actually what we started this discussion talking about, but we've had a couple people ask about it on our Facebook page here, and seeing as how we're coming up on the 2 o'clock press conference in about 45 minutes, we had a couple of people write that while they feel inclined to watch the press conferences because it's informative and they want to know what's happening in their community, the conferences themselves are starting to cause them a great deal of anxiety. And they are wishing that they are viewing the press conferences as basically all doom and gloom. They know they're going to hear negative information. What can they do if they want to, I guess, interject some positivity into that time and not leave the 2 to 3:30 hour of the afternoon every day feeling scared or feeling anxious?
So I'd like to jump in real quick and say that I don't watch it anymore. So I'm not going to be watching it at 2 o'clock, and you're not going to miss anything. Why? Because a couple hours from now, I can look at it on the iPad and scroll through and get the pieces of information that I need. And then I'm in control. Now I'm not saying that you should never have watched them or I'll never watch another one. But I think we've reached a point now where we're actually socializing and preparing ourselves that at 2 o'clock, we all have to sit there, and that's creating more anxiety. So I know some may not agree with that, but I don't see where every single person on this island needs to sit at 2 o'clock every single day and watch through all the hours of that. We can, and again, I'm not discounting what they have to say, but I mean, we have great journalists like Kevin Morales that gives us a nice resume of what's going on afterwards, right? So I'll pick it up this evening and I'll know how many more cases, what's going on, and then I'm done with that. I may watch one again next week or something for the beginning of the week, but we do not have to watch it every single day.
And there's that anticipatory kind of feeling that you get before it comes on, right? So then they're waiting to hear something not good. You know, we're projecting into the future as, and this is what we talk a lot about at our clinic, of that these cognitive distortions, and one of them is future telling and catastrophizing. So we know it's coming. You start to get these physiological symptoms in your body. We start future telling. Oh, I bet there's going to be more cases, you know, or I know this is going to happen today, when really we don't. You know, I recommend that people, you know, as Lockhart says, Dr. Lockhart is in the evening, you know, read, I read like the press briefing or something that someone writes, and it just, you know, I scroll through to look, has there anything changed in what I need to do today? I think, Friday they announced, or a couple days ago, they announced that, you know, there's the extension for 2 weeks. Great. I know what I need to do. I know what my family needs to do. All good. And what we've been talking about this entire panel, and what I see as a key for all of us, myself included, in how to get through this is self-awareness. Just really being self-aware of what is happening to you when the thoughts come to you, when you are around certain people, when you're watching the news, when you're on social media. All of this is what happens for me when I'm in the world. You know, and really trying to gain insight and awareness into, you know, what goes on, how it impacts your body, your thoughts, your behaviors, and then you know what you know, then you can guess what's appropriate for you to do and how to deal with that. You are the master, you are the expert on how to deal with your own life. But when you, you know, when you start to notice that, then you know, okay, it's time, you know, I'm not gonna watch the news today. And that's okay.
Yep, I agree. I think there's a need to know, right? It's that neurological need for information, but it's how we consume it is gonna be an important thing for how we can sustain this long term, right? If this goes on for another couple of months, another couple of weeks, we don't know. So we take it one day at a time. And I'm sort of I've gotten myself into a nice routine where at the end of the day, I can hit the highlight reel. I can fast forward. The government's fantastic. It's all on their website. You can actually watch the whole press conference at a later date. You can fast forward through the things that are not necessarily important. And one of the things that we do, try to do within our family and try to do within our team at work is, yet we can count the number of positives, but man, that negative number is massive. And that's fantastic. And I think sometimes we're very like, oh, there was one more case or four more cases, but there was 48 negatives. And so it's about just looking at the whole truth, right? It is scary to think of one more person that's positive. We can't deny that. But how do we feel when we focus on 50 people that were negative? That's a reason to rejoice. That's a reason to feel really good about our actions. It's a reason to be hopeful. And so it's not just avoiding all information, but it's really making sure that we're being mindful of taking in the whole situation.
Also, Kevin, you had asked, how do we stay positive in that hour? So we suggest maybe don't watch, you know, get your news elsewhere. But sometimes it's nice to go into it and go, okay, wow, look at our government. Like, look at our officials. They're doing a wonderful job instead of what most of us are just, it's a human condition to maybe, you know, look at the things you don't like or, you know, and then that builds upon itself. Wow, like go into it like Dr. Lee's a star. The premier is killing it on, you know, I love the way he's speaking. And, you know, there's certain things that he said that have been helpful for me on how he deals with getting overwhelmed at times. And like, look at our government coming together and really, you know, taking ownership of this and being influencers in the world of how they're taking care of this on our small little island. So, you know, sometimes going into the news briefing with, you know, let's play a game of, you know, like how many jokes the premier kind of says, or, you know, being proud that that's our governor, and, you know, really trying to spin it on looking at ways to feel proud of what's happening here. And of course, I don't expect everybody to do this every single time, but it is a nice way then to start appreciate what we have here. And again, bringing back that perspective of what it's like to live on this island.
If I can just quickly add, you know, these are great points. And I just want to add that that's really a great strategy overall. When we are in a fearful situation, an anxious situation in some way, a way to get through that is to use our compassion and use our gratitude, right, in any situation. So in these moments, and you're watching the press briefings, perhaps, or getting the news, find the things that you can be grateful for. Find the positive numbers, all the negative tests, all those things. And then I just wanted to quickly add as well, if we take this bigger picture outside of just COVID, there is still a lot of great news happening around the world. We've been kind of we have tunnel vision right now onto this issue, of course, because it's so important, of course, absolutely. But let's not forget that there's a great big wide world out there, and there are wonderful things still happening. And there's a news network out there, like goodnewsnetwork.org, I believe, and I've directed some people there. We can get positive news stories still, and like, so seek that out. It's just another little tip to keep people having that positive perspective, that look for those good sources, look for the people that are doing good right now, and all the heroes that we have, the first responders and frontline workers. There's a lot to be grateful for and happy and positive about.
Yeah. And I've been encouraging people to look for opportunities that are coming up. There's so many restrictions. There's so many things out of our control, but it's created new opportunities for creativity, for trying new things, for bonding with friends and family members in different ways. So looking for the opportunities and the good things that can come from this.
All right. Thank you so much. I think that's a great place to wrap up right here. Unless, Shannon, did you want to say something before we go here? Okay.
No,
I just want to...
Oh, okay. No. I was just going to say thank you for inviting us.
And that's what I was going to do as well. I just want to thank you all. I know it's been an hour and a half, and you guys have very busy schedules, and I know several of you have rearranged some things today to be here, so I really appreciate that. And just judging by the comments that we've had on our Facebook stream, I know our audience really appreciates it as well, and this is a very helpful exercise for them. So again, I just want to say thank you very much to Dr. Mark Lockhart. I want to say thank you to Shannon Seymour, Lexi Bodden, Sutton Burke, and Dallas Drolley Shetler, whose last name I have nailed, and I'm very proud of myself for that, for all the time they've given us here today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Take care, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Be safe, guys.
And again, a big thank you to our Cayman Compass audience. Thanks so much for joining us here on this mental health roundtable discussion. This will be available on our Facebook page, so if you want to go back and re-listen to it, you can do it there. We'll also be posting it to our YouTube page. We will also be posting kind of a slimmed down version, a highlights version, if you will, to our website. That's caymancompass.com. I also want to remind everybody that we do have the government press conference live streaming here on our Facebook page. That's coming up in about a half an hour, so stick around for that. And again, thank you so much for tuning in. Have a great day.